Hello, everyone. Today's guest is Gabe Arganchona, class of 2019, and currently working as a pharmacy analytics and business intelligence manager at Kaiser Permanente in Seattle. Welcome, Gabe.
Hey, Connie. Thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here.
So can you first just tell us about your current position and what is it that you do?
Yeah, so like you said, I'm the pharmacy analytics and BI manager for Kaiser Permanente. So what I do is I manage a team of essentially business intelligence analysts and pharmacy analysts. And what we do is we basically answer questions with data. And we do that by developing different dashboards, analytical tools, and reports that our executive leadership team and pharmacy leadership team uses to kind of solve issues with related to pharmacy operations, pharmacy finance, or pharmacy clinical data, and figures out essentially kind of the best route forward for the organization, really from a data-driven standpoint.
For students who are hearing the term informatics for the first time, can you kind of give a introduction to what informatics
is? Yeah, definitely. So working with informatics is you're kind of responsible for managing all kinds of different data. You're really focused on a lot of the tech pieces within healthcare. So you're primarily most of the work you're going to be doing is in your electronic medical record, your EMR, your EHR. And what you're doing is you are kind of applying your clinical knowledge to the IT pieces of that. You're making sure that how those applications function makes sense clinically. And you also make sure that your EHR effectively communicates with other pieces of technology within your healthcare system. So you want to make sure that your EHR effectively communicates with IV pumps, effectively communicates with barcode scanners, with a central carousel and a core pharmacy. Because you don't want to be sending out data or sending out information from the EHR that is then misinterpreted by kind of the receiving piece of technology from that. So it's really just kind of setting up those pipelines, making sure the stuff is interoperable, and then just generally kind of managing the entire kind of clinical IT system.
And sorry, just for students who might not know what EHR is, can you explain really quickly?
Yeah, so an EHR or EMR stands for electronic health record or electronic medical record. So it's going to be essentially where all patients' healthcare data is stored. So common ones are Epic, which most people are familiar with. Cerner is another one. Meditech is another one. Athena also has their own kind of cloud-based EHR. So.
And so now you're about a little over a year out of pharmacy school. What is the most common misperception people or students who are looking into pharmacy school have about a career in pharmacy?
That's a good question. I would say that most people kind of go into it thinking that it's going to be, you're either going to be working in a hospital setting or you're going to be working in a retail setting. I think most people in general just think that pharmacy is kind of a retail setting and you learn a little bit more about a lot of the inpatient stuff. And I was kind of the same way in pharmacy school. I was really focused as either, all right, it's going to be outpatient retail or it's going to be inpatient in a hospital. And I decided, ultimately, I kind of went through it and that was the route I was on. And I got to the end, didn't match with the residency and started applying for informatics positions. And now that I'm sort of past that like post-grad year, I'm realizing like how many things there are available where a pharmacist is like a perfect fit for really any position that requires some type of clinical background or some type of clinical knowledge. So.
Very interesting. And what do you see as the future of pharmacy being? I know there are a lot of changes going on. Yeah.
That's definition of a loaded question. That's a really good call out. I mean, I haven't, it's funny. I think about that. I was even asked that like during my interviews for pharmacy school. And it's really tough to quantify. I think pharmacy is going to kind of shift from this really traditional, you know, someone behind the counter counting pills, giving immunizations, you know, or verifying orders in a hospital, to a place where their clinical background and clinical knowledge is applied to other fields, and not necessarily just within a specific healthcare setting, but within the public health setting, within kind of what I do within an informatics or clinical analytics setting, within the drug development setting, where we're starting to see a lot more pharmacist involvement to that extent. So it's one of those things I think we're still really exploring, like where pharmacists can go and where pharmacy practices headed. So.
And what sort of advice would you give someone who's considering pharmacy school right now?
You know, if you really think that pharmacy is it for you, try and get out there, get some experience, whether You just volunteer as an assistant, or you're able to get a position as a pharmacy technician in the outpatient setting or in the inpatient or hospital setting. Get a little bit of experience, get some exposure, and see if it's something that you really enjoy doing, and seeing if it's kind of a culture and a kind of a job pace that you really enjoy.
How has going to WSU for pharmacy school impacted your career?
Yeah, I would say just like a tremendous alumni network. I would not be where I was today without a handful of people from WSU or kind of laid the path out before me. Just really a solid group of alumni, a solid network out there, always willing to kind of help people out, just give great guidance, great direction, always willing to make an introduction for you, open a door for you, and really kind of help plug you into a field or an area that you are interested in and want to pursue after you graduate.
You're also a hiring manager. When you're looking at new grads and their CVs, what is the number one thing that you're looking at when you're looking to hire someone straight out?
For me, their level of motivation. Like that, skills are great, grades are great, experience is great. If someone has a really high level of motivation, I can tell they're going to be someone who's going to create inspiring work, and they're going to be that type of person that wants to come into work every day. That's the person I want to go with. It's great to have all the fancy certifications like I just talked about in the career series seminar. But really just your level of motivation and, your work ethic, I think are honestly the two most important things. So really finding ways to put that on your CV or put that on your resume, I think will set up a lot of pharmacy students super well in the future.
It seems like you clearly had some sort of drive starting from the beginning of pharmacy school to be very inquisitive about opportunities. What do you think has driven you to the point where you are now today?
That's a good question. I've always been kind of a curious person. I think that's why I work with data. I think you have to be able to ask questions about it. But I came to school, I wasn't necessarily just kind of, competing with my classmates or other people trying to get a residency. I was really just competing with myself, and I kind of wanted to push myself further and further and further. So really going after publications. I didn't want to do just one poster or one publication or one internship. Like, I really wanted to make the most of every experience and kind of build up, my resume, my CV, my background, my experience. And it kind of led me to finding all these other areas where I could apply my skill sets to outside of just clinical pharmacy or retail pharmacy.
Lastly, what is the best career advice you've ever received?
Best career advice I ever received was from Steve Riddle a little less than two years ago at ASHP, where he said, apply for the jobs you are not qualified for. That's what I did. And I got a job that on paper I was not qualified for. So, but yeah, it's, I kind of realized that, recruiters will publish kind of what their dream candidate look like, and not it's not all the time that they get actually their dream candidate. Go out there and just aggressively pursue stuff that might be a stretch for you, might be a little bit out of your realm, because you never know what's going to happen, because you don't know who else is applying for that job. The worst thing that anyone can say is no, and being told no is not that bad. Being told no over and over again is a little frustrating, but write that cover letter, polish up that CV, and go for it.
Thank you for taking a moment to speak with us and your experience. People can think outside of the box when it comes to their careers.
Thanks so much, Connie.
Thanks a lot.